Al-Shabab fighters are losing more ground. That's after Somali forces and African Union troops launched a campaign against the group. But can Al-Shabab be defeated in the end, or is it regrouping for counterattacks? Somalia and the unrelenting battle to uproot Al-Shabab. This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the program. I'm Mike Hanna. Al-Shabaab is on the retreat in southern Somalia. It suffered a series of defeats and setbacks in recent months, including the killing of its leader, Ahmed Gaddani, by American airstrikes. African Union troops have forced the group out of key population areas, and they forced Al-Shabaab fighters to withdraw from their stronghold in the port town of Barawi. But the group has been written off many times before and still controls large areas of southern Somalia. We'll discuss the fight against Al-Shabaab in a moment with our guests. But first, Catherine Soy sent us this report from just outside Barawi.
We are right at the edge of Barawi. There's a troop build-up up to 6 kilometers away. Somalia's government forces, supported by African Union troops from Uganda, are all ready to take the city. The commanders told us that it's only a matter of hours now. They're also getting tactical support from the US and the European Union as well. We're being told that Al-Shabaab fighters and their commanders have left, some by sea, but others have melted into the civilian population. And that's a big concern because they could carry out surprise attacks. I talked to Somalia's deputy chief of defense. He is confident. He says they have the numbers and the might. But everything is still very fluid, and we'll just have to wait to see how this plays out in the coming hours.
But let us first speak with Brigadier General Dick Ollum, commander of the Ugandan People's Defense Force contingent in Somalia, who joins us from Barawi in southern Somalia. Thank you for joining us, Brigadier. The capture of Barawi, how significant is it in the campaign against Al-Shabaab?
Sorry, it is very significant because Barawi has been a very economic area for the Al-Shabaab. Barawi is a tactical headquarter for the Al-Shabaab. As you know, Barawi is the second port next to Mogadishu in Somalia. And I think it is really significant. As you see, AMISOM strives to capture Barawi. It's because of its posture, because of its position, and the nature of the operations that Al-Shabaab take and undertakes in Barawi. That's why we think it's indeed significant to AMISOM.
Now, the campaign that you've been conducting is essentially regular forces fighting against guerrillas. It's a very difficult tactical struggle, is it not, for you and your troops?
Yeah, it is. It is indeed an asymmetrical system of warfare that the Al-Shabaab employed. But we think the AMISOM forces, particularly with the Ugandan force that is undertaking this sector, which is Sector 1, which covers the lower Shabele and part of northern parts of River Juba, we think it's really an aspect of planning, tactical considerations that we have employed. We have faced a lot of attacks from the Al-Shabaab by the use of the IEDs. We have faced the attacks from Al-Shabaab by the use of the snipers, but we think we are on top of the situation.
Now, there are a number of contingents taking part in this operation. Obviously, the UN forces, the African Union forces, and the Somalia government forces as well, who are joining you in this campaign. Command and control structures, is this working well at the moment?
Yeah, it is excellent because, as you remember, AMISOM's, one of the mandates of AMISOM is to mentor the SNA. It's a program that we think, once time for AMISOM comes for going out, the SNA should remain in position to take charge of this situation. But we think, together with the United Nations, together with the AMISOM forces, the Somali National Army, we are on top of the situation. But currently, the entire command of this mission is undertaken by AMISOM. I am only deputized by one of the Somali National Army commanders who works directly under me and in liaison with operational planning from the force headquarters in Mogadishu.
Now, we have seen Al-Shabaab defeated in a number of areas before in recent months and indeed years, but what appears to happen is they leave fighters within civilian populations, and although they appear to be defeated on the surface, they come up again and counter-attack. Is this an ongoing concern, and how do you stop this ongoing process, Brigadier?
Yeah, as strategy has it, Mike, and tactics that we employ as AMISOM, it's very true that much of the fighters of Al-Shabaab will definitely run off from Mogadishu, but a portion of them will definitely come and melt into the population. And this is where we employ a lot of tactics, we employ a lot of intelligence, both human intelligence and technical intelligence, to weed out these specific people that we think are involved into these asymmetric tendencies. And we know that AMISOM, really, with all the specialities in us, together with the partners, from other partners that form part of this AMISOM coalition, we really should be on top of the situation.
Brigadier General Dick Ollum, thank you very much indeed for joining us. Well, to help us discuss this, we are joined by our guest, Abdi Aynte, Director of the Heritage Institute for Policy Studies in Mogadishu, Somalia, and via Skype from Drammen, Norway, Stig Jarl Hansen, Associate Professor of International Relations at the Norwegian University of Life Sciences. Let's begin with Stig Jarl Hansen. We heard there from the Brigadier General the difficulties of fighting what is an asymmetrical battle against Al-Shabaab. Can they be defeated, do you believe, by using this type of tactic?
I think militarily they will probably lose all their holdings because they are not able to withstand the combined forces of the AMISOM and also the new Somali army. That doesn't mean that they will stop fighting, though, because they can start a guerrilla war, and that guerrilla war can last for some time. We should remember that there are weekly attacks in some of the districts in Mogadishu as we speak, although they are supposedly under the control of the government and the African Union. So Shabab can really survive for quite a while as a guerrilla organization. So what they can do now is probably to make it more asymmetrical and make Shabab focus more on guerrilla's doctrines.
Abdi Aynte, your view, is it possible to defeat Al-Shabaab by the conventional military means?
Well, I think defeat is a relative term. Clearly, right now, Al-Shabaab is losing militarily to conventional warfare. And as Stig was just saying, it has been recalibrating in the last 3 years to become a guerrilla force focused on asymmetric warfare. And I think that's what we're seeing right now playing out across Somalia. Al-Shabaab is simply not interested in conventional warfare. It hasn't even put up a battle against the African Union and Somali forces in Barawe just today.
Well, Stig Jarl Hansen mentioning Barawe, how significant is it that they may be losing that particular stronghold?
It has a symbolical importance. So Barawe is one of the last larger coastal towns that the Shabab held. There was a lot of focus on the Barawe when it comes to foreign fighters. So it has symbolical effects, definitively. And it is a blow and a trouble for the new leader. But again, Shabab is recalibrating itself. It becomes more and more of a guerrilla organization within Somalia. Outside of Somalia, it has its outliers as well, and that turns more and more into something that looks like a terrorist organization, you know, using terrorism as a strategy more than guerrilla operations. So I don't think this is the death blow of Shabab. They have received a blow, but I think they will survive that blow.
Well, Abdi Aynte, we heard there the mention of a new leader, the loss of the leader last month, Ahmed Abdi Ghadani. Now, significant there, was the speculation that with a leadership race within the organization, with the jockeying for control, that there may be a period in which it loses cohesion, in which there is a period of infighting. Is it possible to say whether that is happening or is not happening?
Well, I think time will tell. At the moment, it's only been about a month since the new leader had been inaugurated. I think the new leader will probably struggle to retain the organization as a cohesive entity as it was under Ahmed Ghadani, because he simply lacks the charisma, the connections, the experience, and the political shrewdness that Ahmed Ghadani had. But time will tell. I think what's important to look at in the next few days is to try to see what Al-Shabaab makes of the what seems to be the last defeat in a major stronghold in southern Somalia, what that actually means for the organization on the ground. Are they going to try to even put a fight back on, or are they going to strengthen their guerrilla attacks in Mogadishu and other cities? Time will tell.
Well, Stig Hansen, on the issue of the leader, the Ahmed Abdi Gadani, now, interestingly enough, he in fact came from Somaliland. He had no clan structure, for example, on which to rely either in the south or in central Somalia. And the fact that he had such uncontrolled leadership for a period of time would appear to indicate that Al-Shabaab is largely above the clan structures. Is that clan differences is not something that hinders its operations? Is that a valid thought?
I think it's my answer would be yes and no. It's a little bit confusing answer, but Al-Shabaab has to survive in Somalia. So they have to be sensitive to clan tensions. And even today, as we speak, there are definitively some clans that lend more strong support than Shabaab than others. Very often clans that faces local grievances or feel that they are unrepresented in Mogadishu will choose to go on the Shabaab side. And then the result will be that the Shabaab at some occasions will have fighters that are not really there for some kind of global ideology. They are there for local grievances rather than global ideology. That's a part of the picture. Another part of the picture definitively is, you know, the fanatics that wants to implement, you know, some kind of Islamist state in Somalia or indeed the wider region.
Well, Abdi Aynte, this is an issue as well, is it not, potentially within Al-Shabaab? There are the nationalists in there who are fighting, they say, for Somalia, but there are those too who are looking, as Stig mentioned there, at the wider regional control. Is there differences within the organization as to whether it is a nationalist organization or it is something much bigger than that?
Well, Al-Shabaab has gone through an evolution over the past few years. It started as a national entity fighting the Ethiopian invasion in 2007 and 2008. And I think over the last few years, it has morphed into more of a global jihadist organization. I think what remains of the organization right now is a global jihadist organization, and that's why it's struggling in Somalia. If it were to remain a nationalist entity that is focused on nationalist agenda, I think it would have potentially even succeeded in getting some traction within Somalia. But clearly, it has moved away from that direction and into a completely different direction in the last few years.
Well, on that issue of support, Al-Shabaab says it draws its strength from a level of local legitimacy and the income it generates. The group portrays itself as the main force fighting foreign intervention in Somalia and accuses the government in Mogadishu of being backed by foreign powers. The leadership comes from different clans in the area it controls. The group also generates a lot of money, first through raising taxes from local businesses, but also through a charcoal industry, for example, which the UN estimates raises more than $25 million a year. Stig Hansen, that issue of support, where does the support for Al-Shabaab come from? Clearly, it gets some support. It is the fish swimming in a sea, is it not?
I think you are right, you know, and this point is very important to raise. Partly, parts of the Somali army are clan-based, and some of these units are deployed in areas that had some problems with clan tension before. So we can see that actually quite close to Brava, where some clans actually feel alienated. That also goes for the Hiran Valley. From Johar, you know, there are clans that feels that Mogadishu don't represent them properly. And this is a big issue for Somalia. You know, you have an alliance now against the Shabaab, who is quite large and have a lot of important actors within it. But the question is, can this alliance be kept together? I would believe that it can be kept together, but it's something to watch. The federal issue inside Somalia is important for the future development also of Shabaab. What the international community need to do now is actually to keep the allies together, and that has to be watched very carefully.
Well, Abdi Aynte, that we hear there the issue of federalism. This is one of the six pillars of what the Somali government says is its plan, including security as well, of course, to lead to a properly structured federal Somalia. Now, this would, of course, be perhaps the most damaging weapon to use against Al-Shabaab, would it not? A functioning federalism within the country as a whole.
Well, I think that the problem surrounding federalism is much broader than that, and I'm not so sure if it has any direct relationship with Al-Shabaab. The only tangible relationship that one could point out is the fact that federalism would have, in theory, facilitated an effective administration of the local level, which is what is lacking right now. In fact, the greatest challenge that this operation, the Indian Ocean operation that is now against Al-Shabaab, the challenge that it's facing is that it is not succeeding as much in rolling out government administrations in recently recaptured cities. I think that's what the Somali government and the African Union mission has to worry a lot about, instead of only just defeating Al-Shabaab from major cities.
Well, Stig, Hansen, another point of concern that has been mentioned is the African Union forces themselves. You have, for example, the Ethiopian troops in the north. You have the Ugandan forces in the south. Is there an element, perhaps, of they are being used to subvert the clan systems? We had mentioned there that the Somali army, as it exists, there are many functioning clan members within that particular army. The use of African Union forces to try and short-circuit that, does that carry problems within it that may manifest itself as the struggle continues?
I think there are some problems, but there's also a lot of advantages actually with the African Union. But the problem with the African Union is it's really the punch that drives Shabaab away from these cities. It's the African Union who is the major force in the thing. And you had a foreign intervention before. You had the Ethiopian intervention in 2006, which defeated the Shabaab, but the Shabaab was just waiting it out, basically. You know, they were waiting and waiting until then the Ethiopians lost the tummy for staying in Somalia, and institutions that could replace the Ethiopians wasn't established. That institutions was actually functioning very poorly. So the question is actually if you will have institutions that can function without the forces of the African Union. And as I said, you know, Shabaab has seen that they can face numerically superior enemies before and yet prevail. And that's probably what Shabaab is calculating you with now also. You know, how long will the African Union stay in Somalia? What will happen when the African Union pulls out? And if actually the various actors in Somalia now against the Shabaab, as the Yuba state, as Puntland, as Somaliland, as the central government in Mogadishu, if they actually can maintain their act and keep together instead of starting infighting.
Well, Abdi Aynte, that is in a way a very bleak prognosis. The phrase there is that they will wait it out. Well, Al-Shabaab have waited it out before. Is it likely that they are going to do so again, and that's exactly what they are doing now?
Indeed, I think the greatest comparative advantage that Al-Shabaab has at the moment is actually time. They have the luxury of time while everybody else is looking at their clock. The Somali government has about 2 years remaining from its current mandate. The African Union mission will at some point withdraw, although at the moment they appear to have what seems to be an open-ended mandate. So certainly that is a main challenge. But I think one way to overcome that challenge, the challenge of time, is to create effective state security institutions, principally starting with the army, that looks like very inclusive. That will only be the ultimate answer to Al-Shabaab. I mean, the African Union and others could be of assistance in the short term, but in the long term, you really need organic state security institutions.
Well, Stig Hansen, that appears to be the key issue here, the creation of a working governance within a country that has not enjoyed it for decades. Is it inching towards that? Is the new government there actually pushing forward to creating that nexus of security, of structure, that would be the strongest weapon, as I mentioned earlier, against Al-Shabaab?
I think that it's a long road to go, and I don't expect to see a Somali state like it was before 1991. It has to be other solutions, it has to be other structures, etc., etc. But I think there are definitive positive developments. You had the negotiations between the government and the Yuba state last year, and although some of the terms were broken, it's still a ceasefire. there is not a violence between the regional entities and the central government. And that's very valuable for Somalia. You know, there's this kind of coexistence and there's a kind of momentum. There's a lot of problem, you know, in creating a national army, as Abdi Aynte was talking about. You know, de facto has clan units within the army, and sometimes these clan units are not really adapted to the local situation where they put in. They have there are some traditional animosities of the militias or what is called army that is really deployed in specific areas, and that's problematic. You have a rampant corruption. Rampant corruption is serious. That's also an option for the Shabab that they can take advantage of. In order to survive, corruption can be very helpful. We had stories from last year that Shabab was actually in heavily infiltrating parts of the government by buying themselves in and positioning them their own officials within the government. So you have to fight these tendencies towards corruption also. But there are positive signs, and I hope these positive signs will continue. But we shouldn't forget that Shabab already had an impact in the region. Shabab can potentially use its Yemeni connections to help themselves, to have safe houses, etc. We also seen Shabab morphing into something else with networks established in Tanzania, probably in Kenya, probably inside Ethiopia. So there's a lot of tools that the Shabab can have to withstand the positive developments inside Somalia as well. So we should have a on the regional developments. That's also very important.
Yes, Abdi Aynte, this issue of the regional development, obviously the neighbours too are victims of Al-Shabaab, but the fact that you have such vast borders, very porous borders with many of the neighbours, as was mentioned there, the ability for Al-Shabaab to move in and out, their area is not Somalia alone, it is far wider than that, which makes it all the more difficult to defeat them, does it not?
Well, certainly Somalia's neighbors have suffered similarly from the attacks of Al-Shabaab. But one has to remember that ultimately Al-Shabaab is a Somali problem, and you need to fix the problems of this country first. Even for the neighbors, they have to think about how they could be helpful to the recreation of a strong democratic Somali state. Unfortunately, there's sometimes tendency among Somalia's neighbors to view or to fear a strong democratic Somali state, and sometimes they undermine that process, and that's seriously problematic and contributes to the very insecurity that they are actually suffering from. I think what needs to happen is a cohesive and coherent narrative at the region, at the Horn of Africa region level, to think that state building is a huge and long and complex project in Somalia, but without having a combined unified agenda, it's going to be very difficult for Somalia and for the neighbors for in the short term and even in the long term.
Well, Stig Hansen, that's an astute point. The concept that there is a regional responsibility to ensure a democratic Somalia, which may not be exercised at this point.
Yeah, I think so. But I also think that it's important to highlight that although Shabab has been a Somali problem, we now seen large-scale terror attacks inside Kenya. We've seen large-scale attempted terrorist attacks inside Ethiopia. We saw terrorist attacks inside Djibouti, and there was an alleged plot inside Uganda. So this is a heavy plot. It's a heavy burden for the region as it stands, and that's very important. I don't think you will get a fully unified regional agenda. And I also want to point out that the Shabab can also take advantage of, you know, the other weak partner in the region, the one that we don't mention that much. And really, it's related to the troubles in Yemen, and we shouldn't forget that a major source of weapons, if not the major source of weapons for arms used inside Somalia, is Yemen. And the largest foreign contingent, according to Yemen political analysts of the Al-Qaeda in the Arab Peninsula, was actually Somalis. So Yemen is also very important for Somalia, and to fix the Yemeni situation also will help the Somali situation a lot, especially the arms export from Yemen is rather serious for Somalia.
Well, a very complex issue, but at that point, my thanks to our guests, Abdi Aynte and Stig Hansen. And thank you too for watching. Feel free to add your voice to this discussion. You can leave your comments on facebook.com/AJInsideStory. We're also on Twitter. Look for @AJInsideStory. I'm Mike Hanna. From me and the team, goodbye for now.